Welcome to another edition of Diplomacy Academy. Today, I'm thinking about something that frustrates a lot of players, the inability to persuade somebody else that you've got the right idea, that you're the right person to partner up with, that the ideas that you have are the ones that they should adopt. So today's theme is, parle dans la langue qui comprend. Speak in the language they understand. I've got two examples lined up. The first is from the World Championships at DixieCon in 2014. And it's all about how the opening negotiations set the tone for the rest of the game. The second is from a house game that was played online by the Windy City Weasels and Friends in April of 2020. And in that one, we look at how actions speak so much louder than words.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, deadline.
Diplomacy is, at heart, a game about persuasion, about moving people as well as pieces. You can't win if you can't move people, if you only move pieces. So then, what does it mean to speak in a language they understand? It means putting your listener first in your negotiations. Everybody comes to the game of diplomacy wanting to do well, but that means different things to different players. And recognizing that is at the heart of good negotiations. If you have a player who is playing in their first game, or their third game, or their tenth game, they're early in their sort of career as a diplomacy player, their idea of what a good result is will be very different than somebody who is a many-time tournament veteran. And that person will be different than somebody who just plays diplomacy casually. And that will be different than the person who is a long-time diplomacy player but doesn't really like the game and is only sitting down at the table because the tournament director needs one more player to make an even round of seven. Every time you sit down, anytime you talk to somebody, you're trying to persuade them that your ideas are the right ones. Sometimes you're trying to get them on board, to get them on your side to work with you. Sometimes you're trying to persuade them to take an action that will be in their own worst interests. And that's a tough trick. Convincing somebody to do something that's going to be bad for them is hard. You have to first make it look like it'll be good for them, because nobody chooses a thing that's bad for them. So in all of these cases, you have to consider first, what is it that the listener wants? How are they receiving your information? And to take a look at that in diplomacy terms, think about your opening negotiations. You sit down either at your computer and you're sending out your first messages, you're receiving your first messages. What you put out into the world, face to face, online, doesn't matter, is a representation of who you are and who you're going to be in the future. And that message is going to be received by the other player. Now, at the same time, you want to craft that message so that each individual listener hears what you want them to hear in the way you want them to hear it. That's enough theory for the moment. Let's take a look at a practical example.
So if you wanted to work with me against England next year, I'd be very happy to help you by cutting the North Sea from Denmark or whatever else it is that you need.
That was Toby Harris, seen here winning the World Championships in Milan. Toby was Germany in negotiations during spring of 1901 with David Hill as Russia. David had played some online diplomacy with friends as a young man, and he went to a face-to-face tournament and had a bad experience. Now he's a reporter. He writes about gambling and sports and chess. He decided he'd go to the World Championships and bring along an advisor, and the whole thing would be recorded for an episode of This American Life. And who did he bring as his advisor? Ambassador Dennis Ross. That Ambassador Dennis Ross, the American diplomat and author. He served as the Director of Policy Planning in the State Department under President George H.W. Bush, the Special Middle East Coordinator under President Bill Clinton, and was a special advisor for the Persian Gulf and Southwest Asia to the former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton.
What I want to do is get into a three-on-one fight, right? I want it to be you and me and either Turkey or Austria.
Okay.
That was me as Italy. And in general, I think that telling Russia you want to work with them over the long term and right away get in a 3-on-1 fight, that's not a bad pitch. But was it the right pitch? Remember Toby suggesting that he would help out by cutting the North Sea in a future, hypothetically, where Russia was fighting in Scandinavia? Well, was David ready to hear that? Consider that David was a little bit out of his depth. His diplomacy experience mostly consisted of playing online with his friends and going to one face-to-face tournament. And after David, the least experienced player on that board had been going to tournaments for 10 years. That's on the one hand. On the other hand, David had a ringer in his corner, Ambassador Ross, a professional negotiator who was listening to every conversation. We weren't just talking to David, we were talking to Team David, and we were all very much aware of that. In that moment, what David was ready to hear was colored by what it meant for him to do well. And in hindsight, it was probably a lot about not being embarrassed and being the first person eliminated and being completely bamboozled with him sitting there with the microphones rolling and the ambassador at his elbow. And for the ambassador, he's just reading the room. He's listening to what people have to say. He doesn't know the specifics of the game. He doesn't know how to evaluate the various offers of the merits of any tactical suggestions, but he's reading the people. It turns out that made a big difference.
RT is probably my favorite alliance on the board.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so.
Okay.
I mean, no matter what
Great.
Happens, you know,
Great.
When I start with the two-way, I'm sticking with you.
Right, but that I am vulnerable if you cooperate with Austria then, right? Then you could push me out of Rome. That's the thing that...
No, that is not going to happen.
Oh, sure, I understand.
No, I mean, that is not going to happen. I am sticking with you.
Okay, cool.
So at the end of opening negotiations, there'd been a little extra time built into the clock so that Ambassador Ross and David could coordinate before they had to submit orders. And if you go back and listen to the piece on This American Life, you'll hear David say that everybody had been so persuasive and he wasn't sure who to listen to, and how Ambassador Ross didn't have that problem at all.
I think Germany is playing a long game and is just asking you. He's doing it in a very clever way.
Right.
Same with Italy.
Right.
He's doing it in a way where it doesn't look like he's trying to ask you to do things when he actually is asking you to
right.
do something. And the Turkish player, I think, is the one guy who is communicating in a way that I think is most convincing.
Mm-hmm. Dennis said that Turkey reminded him of someone named Sergei Tarasenko. Tarasenko was the Soviet foreign minister's chief assistant. When Dennis first met Tarasenko, he knew he was going to have to work with him on the issue of German reunification, but he wasn't sure if he could trust him.
He said, look, the future of my country depends upon a different kind of relationship with the United States. And the way he said it to me made me feel like it wasn't a manipulation.
Sold. I allied with Turkey.
For Ambassador Ross, it wasn't about the long-term plans. It wasn't about the plans at all. It was about the sense that he got of the commitment of the person making the offer. So, this is just an example where Toby and I are playing diplomacy and we're talking to David, but David isn't the one who's really doing the listening. We don't know how that game would have gone if Ambassador Ross hadn't been there. And to really hammer this home, I want to just, let's go a little further. We go into the next round of negotiations and I get it wrong again. I come in, I make essentially the same pitch with a little more detail, and this is really great because you get some insight into the way it just didn't work at all.
What do you want to have happen over the course of the next 2 years? My long-term plan would be for you and I and Turkey to kill Austria, mm-hmm. and then you and I to kill Turkey.
So it was a tempting offer, and I was flattered. Italy was one of the best players on the board, a former world champion named Chris Martin. But saying yes to Italy meant turning against Turkey. And Turkey had been a loyal ally. So Dennis said no. It's like they say, you gotta dance with the one what brung you.
I still think that even though Italy is clearly the stronger player, Turkey is the more reliable player.
I didn't do very well in that game. I did manage to sneak into the draw, though. You can check it out at This American Life, episode number 351, Got Your Back. At the end of the game, I took the advice that I'm giving here and managed to persuade everybody on the board to see things my way. In the second example today, we turn to a game where we have almost no access to the negotiations. So we're going to look at the ways that the orders that you write and the builds that you put down can sometimes speak louder about your intentions than your words, and how you have to get that part of it right. You have to understand the message that you're sending, right, relative to your audience's expectations. In April of 2020, everything was on lockdown because of the coronavirus, and the local club games that were happening around the world, you know, had to be canceled. So Chicago's 20 City Weasels moved theirs online. They spun up video conference rooms and invited myself, Siobhan Nolan, and Chris Kelly to do a live cast. Brandon Fogel was organizing and ran the whole show. So we came online and we spent about 8 hours total just commenting on these two games as they went through. And bang, right in 1901, spring of 01, we found something really interesting to talk about.
England went to the Channel.
Yep. Oh, Jason Masbaum's in England and Brian Ecton's in France. Of course, Jason went south.
Tell us about that history, Siobhan.
I don't know that they have history personally so much, but Ecton is a very strong player. He can be a controversial one in the face-to-face hobby. I think Jason is spooked and doesn't want to deal with Brian Ecton and is hoping he can just get the jump and move early. I think it's probably going to backfire on Jason.
I know where I put my money on France's fall moves. I think Brian is aggressive. I think he would rather he'd rather go for Belgium, Spain, and Portugal, try and get two builds, even if he loses Brest, on the theory that Jason will convoy to Picardy and he'll get three builds.
There's some inside baseball going on here because Siobhan and Chris and I have all played with Jason Masbaum, who's England, and Brian Ecton, who's France. But at heart, what we're saying is really very simple. When Jason opens to the English Channel and to Wales, he's sending a message with his moves to the rest of the board and to France that says, I am coming for France. It's a very different message than he sends if he opens to the English Channel and Yorkshire or Eddie, where he says, I don't want France in the Channel, but I'm not super concerned about attacking you first. When you send that army south, you're sacrificing any mobility that it might have to go to Scandinavia and committing to trying convoying it across the English Channel. My analysis boils down to the sense that the French player does not believe the English player will just straight up attack him with the simple convoy into Brest.
First thing to notice here is this, right?
Convoy to Brest. Yep.
And he's bounced out of Belgium by Germany. And then the Russia.
So on the Brest convoy, I can report to you what was said in the Zoom room when this adjudication came through.
And okay.
It was verbatim, well done, Jason. I might actually start respecting you now.
That's the Brian Ecton we know and love.
Brian Ecton.
And you're saying this guy has a reputation for being abrasive face-to-face?
No, he's a smooth talker who charms the people with his silver tongue.
That's
Brian Ecton.
Oh, it was a very charming... No, it was an extremely adept negotiation move. He said it in a way that was genuinely complimentary and impressed.
Brian's response, as France, to England convoying into Brest is a great example of speaking in a language they can hear. Other players might blow up. They might get angry and might sort of yell at the English player for lying to them, saying, you know, or attacking them or ruining their game or whatever. Brian doesn't do any of that. What he does is says, well played. I respect that. Now, there's undercurrents of, yeah, you know, he makes it a joke. I didn't respect you before, so maybe I'll start respecting you now. But that's a way to convey the message that, like, okay, now I see us as more equals, maybe we can start to have a real conversation, because everything that happened before was bullshit, because I didn't have any respect for you, but now you've earned my respect. That's a really savvy diplomatic play, and it shows Brian's strength as a diplomat. Jason really can't help but hear that in any way, but like as flattery, and like as sincere flattery, because he went for it, it worked. Well, damn Skippy, you should respect that. And that sets the stage for what happened next.
What's Brian going to do here? He's going to build Army Paris.
Yep.
Going to support Spain to Gascony. And
yes,
bounced out of the Mid-Atlantic Ocean by Fleet English Channel.
Yeah.
While the newly built fleet in Liverpool shows up in the North Atlantic or the Irish.
Newsflash, there is not going to be a fleet in Liverpool.
Oh, you've seen
England. England builds armies in London and Edinburgh.
Spoilers, Chris. You're looking ahead. Oh,
Chris, come on, man.
Let us make our guesses.
Wait, he didn't build Liverpool?
Apparently, he built two armies.
No. Oh, yeah.
Neither in Liverpool.
All right, we might as well move to that. Okay,
it's
yeah. Army Munich,
Jason
Fleet Kiel.
Spooked by being respected by Brian, just said, let me do something that will make him not respect me anymore.
Oh, no, it's Fleet Eddie, Army London. That makes a little,
oh, Fleet
little
Eddie?
Better.
Okay. So for example, convoy to Picardy now with support from Brest.
Bounce as Paris supports Burgundy to Picardy.
Yeah.
Oh, Burgundy can go there. Okay, that guy. I was trying to see what other unit could be brought in.
Five, right? You've now let him out of Portugal. So English Channel
in
allows Portugal to get back to the Mid-Atlantic Ocean. And then you got your whole backfield to worry about because he can get to the North Atlantic. Or
right, so it has to go to the Mid-Atlantic.
So that means that army can't convoy.
If England builds Fleet Liverpool, there is a straightforward tactical path towards the dismantling of France. And a good player, a competent player, is going to understand that. So let's take a look what happens with these builds here. So the order set then becomes something like this. Liverpool goes to North Atlantic, more flexible than Irish Sea, but functionally the same in this instance. English Channel to Mid-Atlantic Ocean, that's to Paris, and we'll go to the North Sea, and we're going to assume that Germany and England are working together here, okay? So you go to Belgium. You move Ruhr in, Ruhr supports Munich into Burgundy. Now you can see that with the cut here, that's going to work. That can't be stopped. So what are France's options from here? Well, you can't let them into the Mid-Atlantic Ocean. That's terrible. You got to get back to Gascony. So let's go ahead and support that move. Since you know that Brest can support Gascony, there's nothing you can do about it, right? Brest can hit Paris and will cut any supports. So then, as Burgundy, your best shot seems to be preventing Germany from advancing and bouncing them out of Belgium. That's the order set that you're likely to aim for as England with negotiations with Germany if you've built Fleet Liverpool. And let's just really quickly walk through what that looks like moving forward. You're France. What are you going to do? What are your options here? The only way that you can get Brest back is to sacrifice Paris. That's a disaster. And if you don't get Brest back, then you've just traded one problem for another. Right now, you're putting Marseille at risk, but just look at it, right? Because Paris is being cut, Paris is the only effective mover for this. And again, you can't let them into the Mid-Atlantic Ocean. This is really bad for France. Nothing else is better, right? Trying to kick him out of Burgundy forces him into a retreat in Marseille, right? Bounce him out of Belgium, you know, not terrible, but boy, howdy, you better make sure that support in Brest gets cut, because if you lose Paris and Brest, you're dead. This is what you angle for if you have built Fleet Liverpool as England. And Germany can hear that, right? Because they can see tactically a couple, you know, seasons ahead and know how that goes. Well, you hope that they can. But that's what you're angling for, right? When you don't have that fleet in Liverpool, it's an entirely different conversation.
Yeah, it really should have been fleet in Liverpool.
Yeah.
Mm-mm. You had to put the fleet in Liverpool.
Yeah.
Fleet Liverpool, fleet London, fleet Liverpool, fleet Eddie.
Double fleets with one of them in Liverpool. Like there's no situation where you're not putting a fleet in. Well, I suppose there is a situation.
This one. I agree that this might be a suboptimal choice. Do you move to the Mid-Atlantic Ocean to prevent Portugal from getting out?
Frank, I think your one advantage at this point is that France still has the one fleet, right?
Yep, just the one fleet.
So you have to bounce it out of the Mid-Atlantic. That's like the only thing, that's the first priority.
Yep.
The conundrum for France is you really want to keep that French fleet bottled up in Portugal. But if you do that, your newly built army in London is useless. So if you're France, well, that speaks to you in a language that you understand, or it ought to. And in Brian's case, it did. England built that army. He's going to use that army. He knows how he has to defend.
In the convoy and it bounced. Yes. Not respecting Jason.
Kiel. Oh, Denmark and Skagerrak. Okay.
And Norway went to St. Petersburg.
Jason, you dot grabby little.
Well, okay.
Oh, that's hilarious.
In the live cast, we were pretty hard on Jason as England because the negotiations that we saw with the moves didn't line up. And it did kind of backfire on him, as Siobhan predicted, fairly spectacularly. That's not necessarily a knock on Jason. We don't know what he said. We don't know what he intended. He may not have wanted to follow through with the attack on France, although we agree that's a bad choice, given the opening convoy into Brest. Nonetheless, what we saw was, on the board, his convoy into Brest spoke to Brian Ecton and said, oh, hey, you're worthy of respect. But then his builds, which needed to be directed towards the German player, didn't add up. If he had built a fleet in Liverpool, he would have had the option, the opportunity to convince Germany that plowing into France was gonna work. He didn't, and Germany didn't. Germany just stood aside, and Jason ended up being eliminated in that game as England in like 1908. So that was a suboptimal outcome from a very, very promising start. What does it mean, then, in the context of these examples, to speak in the language they understand? In the first example, neither Toby nor I met David, Team David, where they were. David, concerned, Ambassador Ross reading us for our long-term intentions. Instead, we were playing a different game. Mark, as Turkey, met David in the right place. And he spoke a language of assurance and trust that worked, and they had a game-long alliance as a result of that. In the second example, Jason and Brian, as England and France, did not communicate well to begin with, but that was to Jason's advantage. Brian wasn't listening, and Jason, you know, for whatever it was worth, managed to successfully make that convoy happen and had a great starting position. But then, when he needed to get Germany on board to finish France off, he used a set of orders that did not speak to Germany in a way that made sense. These kinds of conversations, where it is vital that you convince someone that you have the right idea, you understand the direction the board needs to go, and they need to get on board with you, they happen all the time. And it isn't going to go your way unless you can meet your conversational partner where they are, speaking to them in a language that they understand. That's it for another edition of Diplomacy Academy. If you enjoyed this video, please go ahead and give it a like. And if you want more diplomacy content, go ahead and subscribe. The support that I get from the community, the comments that I receive, they're really, really encouraging for me. And since I came back a couple weeks ago and started doing these videos again, I've really been psyched by the feedback, the encouragement, and the enthusiasm, really, that I've gotten from the diplomacy community. So thank you very much. I also have a Patreon if you guys are interested in offering a little bit of financial support. It really is just for buying equipment to, like, get some better sound gear in here and maybe improve the lighting a little bit. So with that, I want to say thank you very much for all your support. And I'm Chris Martin, and I'll stab you soon.